How many of you are ready for the Word of God right now on this Thanksgiving Sunday? Amen, amen, amen. Let us all stand as we read the scripture for today. The scripture for today is Psalms 100 on the back of your bulletin. Psalms 100. Very familiar passage of scripture for all of us. Psalms 100. I had the preacher sit down. I want them to see the slides. I didn't want them to miss out as well on those things as well. So that's why they're sitting out there today. But Psalms 100, which is on the back of your bulletin, taken from the New King James Version, says this. Make a joyful shout to the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generation. Amen. You may be seated. I'd like to use for a theme today. The theme is thankful. Thankful. We just should be thankful for God. Amen. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you once again for being in your presence. Thank you for your love, your joy, your peace, and your understanding. Heavenly Father, as we prepare to hear your message, allow us to think back of what you've done for us. Lord, think back all the times you have blessed us. And allow us to just say thank you this morning for everything you have done. Lord, if there's somebody here who does not know Jesus Christ as their Savior and want to accept him today, Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit will touch their hearts, that they will receive him today. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Thankful, thankful, thankful. Listen, as we look at this particular lesson today on being thankful, how many of you are thankful that God brought you here this far? Amen. Come on, put your hands together. Just give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Maybe after this message, you'll be a little bit more thankful because really this is a special time of the year just to be thankful to God. But there were, somebody asked several moms what they were thankful for, and a few moms said this. One mom said, I thank God for husbands who attack small repair jobs around the house because they usually make them big enough so we can call in the professionals. that's what someone said. Another mom said, well, I thank God for children. The children who put away their things and clean up after themselves. They're such a joy, but I really hate to see them go home to their real parents. Yeah, another mom said, I thank God for teenagers. Teenagers, because they give parents an opportunity to learn a second language. Last mom said, she said, I thank God for smoke detectors because they let you know when the turkey is done. So, well, what about you? What are you thankful for? What are you thankful for? Are you thankful just for material things, or are you thankful for God bringing you from a mighty long way? Oh, yes, yes. I think your list will probably be just like my list. I thank God for health, right? I thank God for strength. I thank God for my family. I thank God for the nation that we live in, despite of all the flaws that our nation is going through. But this still is the best country in the world. But even more than that, I'm thankful, just like you, for my salvation. I thank God for Jesus Christ dying on the cross for my sins. I thank God for my church family, right? I thank God for his mercy and his forgiveness that he gives us each and every day. But you know, when we think about Thanksgiving, we think about that day on Thursday, this coming Thursday. Have you ever thought about, and some of you probably heard of the story of how Thanksgiving came to be. Now, when I was growing up in school, in grade school, they told us that Thanksgiving started, the first Thanksgiving was when the pilgrims sat down with the Indians, you know, and they ate. No, that's not the real story. Because, you know, good and well, those Indians didn't sit down with the pilgrims. I'm talking about we're gonna have some peace when you taking over their land. That it happened that way. So, but let me give you the real history of Thanksgiving Day, the one we are gonna celebrate on Thursday. It's really probably the most distinctive holiday that we have, because this particular holiday, Thanksgiving Day, is not commemorative of a battle that we fought in America. It's not representing anybody's birthday. It's not representing any anniversary. It is simply a day set aside, listen to this, it's a day set aside to express our nation's thanks to the God of the Bible. Did you know that?
Yeah.
Our nation set aside a day to give thanks to the God of the Bible. And the reason I say the God of the Bible is because there's a lot of other gods out there, right? There's the God of the Quran, and there's the God of the Mormons, and the God of the Jehovah's Witnesses, the God of the Buddhists. So I wanted to say the God of the Bible, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that God. So why do we celebrate? When was the first Thanksgiving? Well, in 1789, it was George Washington, the very first president of the United States, made this first public proclamation to the whole nation, and I'll read just a little part of it for you. And it was absolutely a very strong statement to let you know at one point in our church, in our nation's history, we wanted to praise God. We wanted to give God glory. We, as a nation, so all of this separation from church and state, that wasn't a part of it, because you're about to listen to what the first president of the United States said about Thanksgiving and why he wanted to start it in 1789. By the president of the United States of America, a proclamation is this: whereas it is the duty of all nations to acknowledge the providence of Almighty God. That's what George Washington said. To obey His will, to be grateful for His benefits, and humbly and explore His protection and favor. And whereas both houses of Congress, that's the Senate and the Representatives, did you hear that? He said Senate and the Representatives, have by their joint committee requested me to recommend to the people of the United States a day of public thanksgiving and prayer to be observed by acknowledging with grateful hearts the many signal favors of Almighty God. Did he say God in a sentence? You can't get Obama to say anything like this today. You couldn't get the president before him to say it. You couldn't get the president before him to say it. So we live in a time where our nation has pulled so further away from God that this is the very first president of the United States. He's not done. Listen what he says. He says, so now, therefore, I do recommend and assign Thursday, the 26th day of November next, to be devoted by the people of these states to the service of the great and glorious being who is the beneficent author of all the good that was, that is, and that will be. So we read what the very first president said. He gave honor to God.
Amen.
That's why we should have Thanksgiving. It's not a time for you to just sit around and watch the football game. It's not time for us to just sit around and eat all the food that we could see. It's the time to separate, to sit down and say, you know what? I'm going to give God thanks for what He has done for us.
Amen.
And here we are, 226 years later, and the more thing we talk about is we're thankful for what the stuff we have instead of what the person who has given us the stuff has done for us. It's sad, and I think that this Psalm 100, it's going to give us a better attitude. It's going to give us an attitude on how we should praise God. It should let you know that, number one, the purpose of Thanksgiving is this. This psalm was written, watch this, this psalm was written for Israel, the people of Israel. And why is that? It's because when God delivered Israel out of bondage, if you can remember, God brought them out of slavery, out of 400 years of slavery, and he said this to them. He said this, when you come into the promised land and settle down in your warm homes and you have plenty to eat, don't forget me. I led you out of the wilderness and I brought you into a land flowing with milk and honey. So those people should have really been appreciative of this Psalm, Psalm 100, when God said, listen, I want you to praise me every chance you can get. But some people may say, well, if that's only for Israel, what about us? And as you can see on point number B, it's not just for Israel, it's also for us as well. We, through this psalm, is going to teach us that we who are not Jews should also praise God. Well, where do you get that from? Well, if you will look at it, the first verse says this. It says, and it is addressed to all the earth. Make a joyful noise, right? To the Lord. All you lands. That's everybody. That's not just Israel. Then the last verse says that it includes all generations. So God was so clever when he wrote Psalms 100. He included not just the Israelites, but he included every generation. He included every nation, every group of people to say this, you need to give God praise every chance you can get. So this message of thanksgiving is so deep that it hits every age, it hits every generation, it hits every nation, it hits every family. So you can walk away from this message today and say, yes, I do now understand that I need to give God praise in my life. Amen. Did you know it's very sad? It's very sad that we are the only country in the world, except for Canada and the Philippines, that have a day of thanksgiving. And did you know what kind of world we would have if everybody had a day that they just set aside to be thankful to God? What if we had a day that everybody in the world would just say, God, I thank you for being alive. I thank you for my health and strength. We wouldn't see as much crime as we see in our world today. Amen. We wouldn't see as much murder as we see in our world today. And that lets you know that people are not thankful for God for being who he say he is. Yes, oh, yes, you got to be thankful for what you have. Watch this. Not only that, you don't base your thanksgiving on how much you have. You know that people thank God for the turkey. You know, God, you know, I thank you because I can eat it all day. Thank you for my bank account because I know I have some money there that's going to supply me. Thank you, God, for my health and strength. But wait a minute. Don't you know you shouldn't just thank God for all the good things that's happening to you? Don't you know you should even thank God for the bad things that are happening to you? Because don't you know that your circumstance can change at any moment? You are just one paycheck from a shelter. Did you know that? Did you know your circumstance? You're just one step away from slipping on something and you can't walk for the next 5 years. You better thank God even for the bad times. Thank God even for the difficult days because it's God that's going to bring you out. Don't get caught up and say, God, I just thank you for what I have, because then you'll get the wrong impression that the only time you should give God thanks is when you get a new car, is when you get a new house, is when you get a new dress or a new suit. You should thank God that he woke you up this morning. Amen. I know I may just have some cheese and bread in the refrigerator, but I thank you for the cheese and the bread. I know I got this job. I know it's getting on my nerves, but God, I thank you that I'm working today. Yeah, don't just thank God for what you have. Don't just thank God for your health. Thank him for everything. Thank him for everything because he is the Lord who's going to bring you out. And if you don't know, you should always keep the Lord in your mind. Let's take a quick glance of Psalms 100 real quick. And it says this. I'm just scanning it real quick for you. It says this in verse 1. You'll find in verse 1 the name of the Lord. You ought to serve the name of the Lord. Obey the name of God. In verse 2, you will find the name of the Lord. In verse 2. In verse 3, you will find the name of the Lord. In verse 3. In verse 4, you will find you got to enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Yes. And in verse 5, you'll find the name of the Lord again. So all throughout the psalm, you're finding out that you need to serve the Lord. It's him you're thankful for. Right. It's him you're giving gratitude to.
Right.
somebody, if you remember Alex Haley, that's the person who wrote Roots, and they made a movie off of it. If you remember him, Alex Haley, in his office, he has a picture of a turtle sitting on top of a fence post, right? And somebody was in his office one day and they asked Alex, hey, Alex, why do you have that picture? What is that picture representative of? Well, Alex Haley said, every time I sit down and I write something that I think is significant, and every time I think that when I begin to write and discover things and I look to myself and say, Alex, you're a bad boy. Every time I think and my mind gets puffed up in pride, I look over at that picture and I see that turtle sitting on top of the fence post and I say to myself, that turtle didn't get on top of the fence post by himself. Yes. Somebody helped or put the turtle on top of the fence post. And so he had to say, somewhere, somehow, somebody helped me make it to where I am today. What about you? You didn't make it to where you are by yourself. Somebody along the way helped you. Somebody along the way gave you a little push. Somebody along the way gave you encouragement. It could have been your parents, grandparents, aunt, uncle, the person down the street, but somebody poured something in you that made you say, I can make it just another day. Isn't God good that he put those kind of people in your life? Don't get caught up into pride thinking that you've done everything by yourself, because you haven't done nothing by yourself. God has always put people in your path that's going to give you help along the way. Second point, this is my last point. I only got 2 points out of the whole sermon. That's this. There are 5 commands for Thanksgiving. 5 commands for Thanksgiving. Let's look at command number 1, and it's this. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. It means to shout with the force of a trumpet blast. It means this. You need to shout and let the world know that it's God that's fixing your situation. You need to shout and let the world know that you are born again. You need to shout to the world that God is the one that's turning your situation around. You say, why should I shout? Let me ask you this. Have he ever solved a problem for you? Then you got a reason to shout. Has he ever given you direction in your life? Then you have a reason to shout. Maybe he provided a blessing for you. Man, I don't know. Then that's a reason for you to shout. So you need to shout. You know, I see everybody else shout. The homosexuals shout that they're homosexual. Right, right. The guy who's married to 3 persons, he shouts from the rooftop that he's married to 3 people. You got folks on Facebook and on YouTube posting the crimes that they have committed, and they're making video. Look at all the money I just made. Yeah, see, they shouting about what they do. How come Christians can't shout that God is good? How come we can't shout that we live the life that God has caused us to live? Why are we so ashamed to, I do serve the Lord? Why are you so ashamed to tell somebody you serve the Lord? They need to know that you serve him. They need to know that it's God that's making a way, not you making a way. Other people need to know that God is in your life, and when they find out, guess what? The Holy Spirit may touch them, and they're going to follow you instead of you following them. Oh yeah, so you gotta shout. You gotta shout. What's number 2? Number 2 says this. Number 2 says, serve the Lord with gladness. Isn't that something? We need to serve the Lord with gladness. It didn't say serve the church, did it? It didn't say serve the preacher. It didn't say serve the leaders. It didn't say serve the organization. It said this: serve the Lord with gladness. You know, the Bible teaches that if you witness on behalf of the Lord, if you feed the hungry, if you clothe the naked, if you work for the Lord, whatever you do for him, that you are serving the Lord. That's right. When you work for him, those people that came this morning and they helped put those baskets together, they were serving the Lord. You're not serving the preacher. You're not serving me. You're serving God. When you help somebody, even pick them up on a bus stop and say, I'll take you where you need to go, you're serving the Lord.
Amen.
What does the Bible say? The Bible says this. Read this. It says this in Matthew 25:40. Jesus said, inasmuch as you have done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, you have done it unto me. So when you help somebody along the way, guess what you're doing? You're helping the Lord. That's right. God is using you. Why do we think that the only time God uses us is when we're in these four walls? No. He uses you outside the four walls. He's not just using you in the choir stand. He's just not using you in the pulpit. He's just not using you all as an usher or as a nurse. He's using you when you help somebody who is less fortunate than yourself. Don't you know that God will bless you when you become a blessing to somebody else? Oh, yes. And you need to say, Lord, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Maybe we don't want to serve him because we serve him out of obligation. You shouldn't serve him out of obligation. You shouldn't come to church because you think it's your right, it's your duty to come to church. You should come to church because God has been good to you and he saved your soul. He made you whole. He turned your life around. Maybe some people come to church because they have guilt and fear. Listen, God says he didn't give you the spirit of fear, right? He gave you the spirit of love and of a sound mind. So you should serve him out of love, not because, oh, if I don't do it, I'm going to die and go to hell. No, that's not why you should serve him. You should serve him because you know that he loves you enough that he gave his only begotten son to die on the cross for you. Yo, yeah, it's natural. It's natural for us to want to feel appreciated when we do things for people. But sometimes you're not going to get a pat on the back. Sometimes people are not going to recognize you. Sometimes you ought to do good just because it's good to do. And you're not looking for somebody to pat you on the back. You're not looking for an award. You're not looking for a certificate. You're looking for God when he say, when you get to heaven, well done, thou good and faithful servant. I know that nobody know it was you that provided the food for that family down the street. I know nobody knew that you paid somebody's bill for 3 months. I know that nobody know that you sent somebody else's child to college. I know you didn't know that. They didn't know that. But I saw you. Yeah, I saw what you've done. I'm going to appreciate you when you get here. Instead of us always holding our hand out, we need to also put something in somebody else's hand. Just because it's right to do. What's the third command? The third command is this. Watch this. It says, come before him with joyful songs. Before I go further, I want you to notice three things just in the three commands that we just covered. In the first three commands that we just covered, did you know each one of those commands, God wanted you to be happy? And let's go back. Let's go back. Command number one, make a joyful noise. That's happy. Number two, serve the Lord with gladness, happy. And here's number three. It says, well, come before him with joyful songs. God's goal is for you to be happy, right? God's goal, but in order for you to be happy, you need to be happy in him.
That's right.
Not in yourself. You see, joy doesn't come from the deep depths from within you. Joy comes from serving the Lord.
Amen.
Oh yeah, he said, yes, I want you to be happy. And you say, what should I be happy about? Well, the fact that this God gave his only begotten son. Look at your neighbor right now. Do they look happy to you? Well, they got frowns on their face. Nobody should have a frown on their face. If you know how good God has been to you, you should have a frown on your face. Did you know it was God that protected you last night? Somebody wanted to break in and rob you, but God said, no, not that house. Somebody wanted to break in your car. Somebody wanted to do harm to you, but God said, no, not today. It was God while you were sleeping in your bed. Still protecting you. And you mean to tell me you wake up in the morning, good morning, what's good about it? Let me tell you what's good about it. God is good about it.
Amen.
I'm a morning person. Every time I wake up, my eyes, I jump right up out of bed. Thank you, Lord. I can get out of the bed. It's a good morning. I may not feel my best. I may not even want to go to work, but I go because he allowed me to. He allowed me to. I press on and I press on. Even in the rough days, you gotta keep pressing on and say, God, thank you, because I couldn't have this job. I thank you anyway. Look at the fourth command. Not only did he say that, he says this in the fourth command. Know that the Lord is God. And then the verse goes on to say, and I didn't put it all up there, but it says, know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. The first thing is, God made you.
Amen.
He says, the Lord made you. Notice what he says. He says, for he is God, he who has made us, and not we ourselves. You didn't make yourself. God made you, right? So that means that God took every bone and every joint, and he welded them together with nerves and with muscles, and then he covered your body with skin, right? And then he gave you eyes to see. He gave you a brain to think, and he gave you fingers to pick up things. Yeah, that's what God did for you. He created you. So why would you think that you don't deserve to give him some praise, to give him some glory? It was God who made you. And here's another thing. If God made you a woman, then you need to thank God he made you a woman. He didn't make you a man. So don't act like a man. Amen. God made you a man. If you're a man, he made you a man for a reason. So that you should be thankful for the way you've been made. They want to go against God, so I don't even like the way I was made. You know what? I'm going to change my name to Caitlyn Jenner. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to change my name. I'm trying to change my whole sexual orientation because I don't like the way I've been made. And that's a problem because this verse says God made you.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. He made you the way he wanted you to be. I don't know about you, but I thank God for making me. Yeah, I thank God for the providence that God decided to make me have medium height, right? He decided to make me the color, the skin color that I am. He decided to make me with coarse hair that's receding and is about to leave my mind. Yeah. But he also made me a faithful husband, right? He also made me a faithful father. He also made me a faithful servant of the Lord. So it don't matter what I look like on the outside. God is the one that made me, and I thank him for it. Oh, yeah. Thank you. You should thank him for it, too. Yeah, we got to realize. We sometimes become dissatisfied with the way we look and what we've been dealt with. But guess what? God is the one who should have been dissatisfied, because when Adam and Eve fail, God became dissatisfied with the sins that we started being a part of, right? So God doesn't like the temper that you have. God doesn't like that you are weak and that you fall sometimes. But guess what? He still loves you, and he still gives you mercy. He still gives you grace so you can make it each and every day. We serve a good God.
Amen.
You know that song we used to sing, please be patient with me. God is not through with me yet. And when God gets through with me, I shall come forth like pure gold. So don't you try to catch up with somebody else. God, you're on God's timetable, nobody else's timetable. Your maturity in Christ is based on your study, is based on your deliverance of God, I want you to work in my life. That's how far we will see you will grow each and every day if you are consistent in studying his word. Another thing it said in that verse, it says, we are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Notice it says, we are his people. Do you find that people want to be the shepherd? People don't want to follow, they want to be the shepherd. But the scripture says in this verse that the shepherd does what? Leads you beside, another pastor says, leads you beside still waters, right? So if you want to be a shepherd, we find shepherds, because they weren't meant to be shepherds, leading people astray instead of leading them beside still waters and finding green pastures. But if you let the Lord lead you, if you let him be your shepherd, he will lead you in the right direction every single time. As a matter of fact, Psalms 23 will become perfect in your life. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Yeah, let's look at the last one. The last command is this. It says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and to his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. And then the last verse says, I'll put it in there, for the Lord is good. And his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues throughout all generations. In the Old Testament, the temple symbolized the presence of God. But we don't have those temples today. So what is the temple of God? When it says enter into his gates with thanksgiving, what I'm going to enter in today, is he referring to this place? I want to go a little further and say he's going further than that. He's referring to your body itself. See, watch this. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, the Bible says. So that means wherever you enter, guess what you're bringing in? You're bringing in God. You're bringing in the Holy Spirit. And so wherever you enter, wherever you go, you should enter with thanksgiving. When you go to work, you just enter into work. You should have a praise on your lips. Yeah. When you go to work, enter in with thanksgiving. Yeah. When you go to the hospital, even though he told you some bad news, you need to go in there entering with thanksgiving. Yeah. Don't let any other person's negative attitude stop you from entering in with thanksgiving. Somebody says something negative, you say something positive back, because you're supposed to enter into his presence. Watch this. With thanksgiving. All right. So then, no matter what, you know, you heard me say this joke all the time. It could have been worse, you know, it could have been worse. Anytime somebody say anything negative to you, just tell them, it could have been worse. And they're going to get sick and tired of coming to you every single time, telling you how bad it is. And you need to tell them, it could have been worse. But you know, I heard about these three people got shot last night. It could have been worse, because it could have been you with those three people. Somebody lost their house. It could have been worse. The whole block could have lost their house. No matter what people say, you need to say it could have been worse. And then you need to top it off with that. But for the grace of God, there go I. That's what you should say. It could have been me in that house. It could have been me in that car. It could have been me on that street. It could have been me in Paris. It could have been me in my valley in Africa. I could have been there. You could have been there. But God's grace and God's love allowed you to live just another day.
Amen. Amen.
We're living a wild time. I don't know about you. Maybe you got something. You know something I don't know. I don't know when I'm going to leave here. So I'm going to give God every minute and every second of the day to praise him and thank him for what he's done for me right now. I love when Martin Luther King said, I don't know what the future holds, but I know who holds the future. His name is God. He's the one. So I can look into the future. I don't know who the next president is going to be, and I'm not worried about who the next president, because God, he's blessed me with the years of Obama. He blessed me when both Bushes was in the house. He blessed me when Ronald Reagan was in the office. I can name him. I go back to when I was a little kid. He blessed me. Who was that in the 70s? What was his name?
Carter.
Carter was it? No, I'm not that old. I don't remember Nixon. When Carter was in, and God blessed me all of those years. And guess what? If he can do it for the past 48 years, don't you think he can give me another 48 years? And no matter who's in that office, no matter who's the mayor of the city of Detroit, if you keep praising him and you keep giving him glory and honor, God is going to bless you. So yeah, that is the source of thanksgiving. The source of thanksgiving is this: give God praise. Don't stop praising him. And why should we never stop praising him? Because the Bible says this in Psalms 103. Oh Lord, help us to be thankful that you do not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. So we should thank God, because if God gave us what we deserve, none of us would be sitting here right now. If God showed us what we really should be going through, none of us would be sitting here today. So what should you do? You should just be thankful and thankful and thankful that God has blessed you a mighty long way. Who's going to put their hands together, give a God a hand of praise and be thankful? Why should you be thankful? It's because Jesus died on the cross over 2,000 years ago. You still should be thankful. You should be thankful that he loved you enough to come down 42 generations. And he wrapped himself in human flesh. And he was born of a virgin named Mary. You should be thankful, because God is the one that allowed Jesus to come down from judgment hall to judgment hall. He was whipped for you. He was bruised for you. They spit in Jesus' face. And they beat him on top of his head. They put a crown of thorns on him. You should be thankful. Why? Because he did it not for himself. He did it for you. Yes, as bad as we are, as messed up as we are, he still died for you and for me. He died for the people in ISIS. Yes, he died for them. He died for the mass murderer. He died for them. He died for the prostitute. He died for the drug addict and the drug dealer. Yes, we should be thankful, because the Bible says in the book of Ephesians, Ephesians, we were such as some of them. We were in all of those lists. I don't know a person sitting here today that God didn't deliver us from something. He delivered you out of something. He pulled you out of sin and out of shame. There's nobody sitting here today that lived a perfect life. There's nobody here sitting today that never sinned against God. So you should be thankful. You say, well, I don't know how to express how thankful I am. Then just say, God, I thank you for the sun that shines. Thank you for the moon that shines. Thank you for the peace that you give me since I met Jesus. God, I thank you. They hung him wide. They stretched him wide. He bled and died for you and for me. But the story don't end there. It says on the third day, say I'm thankful. Stand on your feet and tell the Lord you're thankful. Put your hands together and say, Lord, I thank you. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for yesterday. Thank you for tomorrow. Lord, I'm thankful that you filled me with your precious Holy Ghost. Lord, I thank you that you gave me a new mind. You gave me a new heart. And you're on your way back again. Lord, I thank you. Bless him every single time, every head bowed and every eye closed. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you once again for allowing us to be in your presence. Thank you for your love, your joy, and your peace. Thank you, Father, right now for those who are here just giving you praise, giving you thanks, giving you honor. But right now, in the name of Jesus, Father, we want to offer an invitation to those who have never accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior. The doors of the church are always open. And if you have never accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, I want you to pray this prayer with me, because I don't believe in leaving here without praying with someone who wants to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. We don't know what tomorrow holds. We don't know what's going to happen on this week. So if you're here today and you want Jesus to be the head of your life, just pray this prayer with me. Repeat after me, Father, in the name of Jesus, I come to you as humble as I know how. I come to you as a lost sinner, understanding that Jesus died and he was buried and rose on the third day. I believe he died for my sins, and I believe you rose him from the grave. I accept him right now into my heart as my Lord and Savior, in Jesus' name, amen. If you just prayed that prayer, the doors of the church are open for you today.